Yesterday what all we have covered, let us revise once. So this was the topic that yesterday we were taken up, isolated versus memory mapped I/O. So here in this, we are talking about this, yesterday we have seen what is isolated means. In this isolated, here in the buses, we have seen here, we have the bus system. This data address control, these are the I/O bus. So these are I/O bus. So here the other side we may be having memory bus, wherein this processor is trying to communicate with the RAM and ROM like that. So how do we manage this I/O bus? How do we manage the memory bus? So that was the topic. Yesterday we dealt with this I/O bus and interface modules. So here in this, we have the means, like these are the three methods or three ways how this computer buses are handled. So one is to use a separate bus, one for memory, the other for I/O. This yesterday we have seen. Any doubts about this? Yes. If you have any doubts about that, if no doubts, you please type in chat window no. Do you have any doubts about that yesterday's? No doubts, okay. So, okay, all right. So, here, similarly, we have seen yesterday this one. Use one common bus for both memory and I/O, but have separate control lines. And the other last one is, yesterday this also we have seen, use one common bus for both memory and I/O, but separate control lines. I was, yesterday I was telling you like, we have this I/O read and I/O write control lines when we want to transfer to the I/O devices. Memory read and memory write control lines are there. These are the control signals or control lines for memory transfer. When processor wants to transfer, here, when processor wants to transfer anything to the I/O devices, or if it wants to take anything from the I/O devices, then the control here, the signals that are available are I/O read or I/O write, depending upon the requirement here. So here the processor, if it wants to communicate to the memory, then the control signals that comes here are memory read and memory write. So two separate control lines, whereas data line and address line will be common. So that is the second one. This second one is called isolated I/O. So that we have seen yesterday. So let us take up today this memory map I/O. So if you have any doubts, you can unmute yourself and you can ask, because again I have to come out of this presentation mode, this PPT, then I have to check the chat window there. It is a time consuming process. So someone, if someone having doubt, they can unmute themselves and talk. I will just count 5 times. You can unmute and you can talk. 5, 4, 3, 2. Okay, I guess no doubts. So let's continue with memory mapped I/O. So this in this memory mapped I/O, this is the third method. What is the third method? These are the methods we listed here. Use two separate buses, one for memory and the other for I/O. This is method one. Use one common bus for both memory and I/O, but have separate control lines for each. This is the second method. The third method is, use one common bus for memory and I/O with common control lines. So that is the third method. And this third method is also called memory mapped I/O, memory mapped I/O input output. So here what happens is, the other alternative is to use the same address space. Address space is same for both memory and I/O. Let us say 0 to 64. This is one set. And 65 to 128. This is another set. So 0 to 64, let us say we are connecting it to memory. And 65 to 128 in this address space, let us say we are connecting it to I/O. So that is called separate address space, not same address space. Separate address space. That is happening here in earlier cases. That is before this memory mapped I/O, we have isolated, and the other one first method. In that case, separate address space. But in case of memory map, we have 0 to 64 only, this space only, for connecting memory as well as I/O device. So how is that processor is going to distinguish which is a memory and which are the I/O devices in the given address space? That is what we are going to discuss in this memory mapped I/O. So I repeat again, this memory mapped I/O uses everything common, common bus and common control lines. So the other alternative is to use the same address space for both memory and I/O. This is the case in computers that employ only one set of read and write signals and do not distinguish between memory and I/O addresses. Obviously, but this third point is very for obvious reasons. Here, when we are having the same address space, obviously there is no difference between memory and I/O address. So this configuration is written I/O. So in this memory, the summary here is, we are using the same address space, that is 0 to 64 for memory as well as for I/O devices, and also the same control signals for read and write. So the computer treats an interface register as being a part of the memory system. This interface register means you might be knowing at this stage, you should be able to recollect what is meant by that interface register. This inside this interface, we have this circuit. So this circuit is having inside some decoder circuits, some registers. So that one here, we are talking here, memory mapped I/O. Here, the computer treats an interface register, that interface module earlier I have shown, as being part of the memory system. The assigned addresses for interface registers cannot be used for memory words, which reduces the memory address range available. So in this, further if you continue, in a memory mapped I/O organization, there are no specific input or output instructions. In earlier case, we were having separate instructions. So those instructions, when being decoded, they will generate I/O read, I/O write, those sort of signals as a output, or memory read or memory write, like that. So for memory read, for memory write, separate instructions are required. For I/O read, for I/O write, separate set of instructions are required in earlier case. But since here we are having common control signals, we don't need separate instructions. A common instruction is enough. So in a memory mapped I/O organization, there are no specific input or output instructions. So how is that it is going to handle in further discussion with the CPU? The CPU can manipulate I/O data residing in interface registers with the same instructions that are used to manipulate memory words. This is again the same story here in this point, whatever we discussed, the same here. The CPU can manipulate I/O data residing in interface registers with the same instruction that are used to manipulate memory words. Why? The reason is we have the common control line for read and for write. Earlier, separate control signals were coming out, but here common control line is there. So this common control line is having, for example, let me take the help of this one. 1 minute. I'm just trying to graphically represent this one by drawing before I can. Just a moment, it is coming up. By the time this software comes, I think it can continue. The Inkspace paint software sort of. I don't know, it's taking time. We'll see the other alternatives. So here. Are you able to see? Can someone unmute and say what I'm drawing? Can you able to see?
A box.
Yeah. Yeah, but able to see, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay, fine. That's great. So, say, let us say here is a 0, and here is a last one is a 64. And what I do is, in this memory, this is a memory. So in this memory, here till 31, here let us say 31. What I have planned is, at 0, I have planned to connect here keyboard. At 1, I have planned to connect printer. I have planned to connect here printer. So likewise, I/O devices, what I'm planning is, between 0 to 31, I am planning my I/O devices. From 32 through this last number 64, it's my memory space. I can keep here inside the computer. You have this random access memory. So RAM. So this inside this 32 to 64. I can keep anything inside this memory, depending upon my computation, my program. Suppose this program, very program, this paint program, now it is consuming my memory, RAM. So what all I am doing here, it is going inside the RAM and it is getting, it is using that RAM now. So memory is used. So this way, what I am planning is, now the control signals I can have here, I'm trying to take some other color. I don't know. I can pick here, I think, this color. Okay. So is this visible, this color? I'm
not clearly.
Not clearly. Okay. I'll do one. So now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us say this first one is a read control signal, read. Okay. And the second, this one is a, let us say this is a write control signal. Yeah. So now, these are the two control signals enough for the processor to, okay. I'm able to make space, some space here. So now the processor is here. So this processor now can use same common bus. This is the common bus for address, for data, and for the control. So this control last one, this one, this is a control. Let us say this is a control. Control line. So if this control line is going to 0 to 31 space, then it is treated like for I/O devices. When this control is going to 32 to 64, it is treated like we are addressing for a memory like that. Yes. Is that clear? Am I able to make the things clear here, what I am trying here in this slide here? If one or two members can able to unmute themselves and talk, it will be helpful for me.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's great.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you so much. If someone that's the thing here, that's the point here in the this. If this is clear, if this is clear to you people, then we are able to grab the point there. Memory mapped I/O means this is the memory mapped I/O. This is the entire thing is a memory only here. If this memory partly used here 0 to 31 is used to connecting the I/O devices. You know at this stage what I/O devices we mean. And 32 to 64 we are using as a RAM. So now the control signals that are coming out of this processor, when they are going to 0 to 31 space, and along with that, whatever the data that goes, whatever the address that goes, actually it is very much understood that we are actually meaning here I/O device, not the RAM. When processor really tries to give the address for this space, that is 32 to address and data, anything that is given here, given here, that will be going to this 32 to 64 address space. So that's what this memory mapped I/O is managing. This is how memory mapped I/O is managing with a common address, common data, and a common control lines. So the CPU can manipulate I/O address residing in interface registers with the same instructions that are used to manipulate memory words. Each interface is organized as a set of registers that respond to read and write requests in the normal address space.
Sorry, your voice is breaking.
My voice is breaking. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So typically a segment of the total address space is reserved for an interface. I'll take a but in general they can be addressed as long as there is not a memory word that responds to the same address. I think this point is very clear to you. Typically, a segment of the total address space is reserved for interface registers. But in general, they can be located at any address as long as there is not a memory word that responds to the same address. This point, again, I just want to go back here. This paint again. Let us take this time new. How to take new here? I don't know where is that new man.
Click on files and you also will.
On files, yes. Thank you so much. So don't save this one. Okay. So now here, this is the memory available. And I don't really need 0 to 31. I have to have I/O only. There is no such a standard compulsory rule that, and 32 to this, let us say 64, I have to have memory as a memory. So there is no such a standard rule. I can put here. What I can do here is, for example, this way, let us take one more different color. And here, I can put here, somewhere here, this address, suppose say this is some 16. I can use this 16 as a memory. And 30, somewhere here 40, let us take 40 address space. And this 40 as a I/O. And inside the processor, I can tell the processor that here, this is address lines are there here. This is address line, first one, or data, second is the data, then the control. So if this control signal and this address, control and address, this two, if it is set by the processor that at this address, which address? At this 16, let me take the other color. At this 16, what I have is not a IO, not a IO, it is a memory. At this 16, I don't have IO device, it is a memory space. Like that, if processor, to processor, if we could able to say it through program, then definitely this 16 is not for IO device, rather this 16 space is for memory only. Similarly, earlier I was talking about 32 to 64 continuously for the RAM, but if you have planned to have IO device at 40, then you can do so. At 40, you can connect a IO device. Only thing is, in the program, you have to tell that at the 40 space, you don't have any memory, rather it is a IO device. Am I clear now about this? Yes, someone can unmute, because I'm not going to chat window. Someone can unmute and tell, am I clear about this point I'm trying to say? Typically, a segment of the total address space is reserved for interface registers, but in general, they can be located at any address as long as there is not a memory word that responds to the same address. Is that this point pictorially I represented to you people? Was that clear?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay, that's great. Let us move to the same memory map. Computers with memory mapped IO can use memory type instructions to access IO data. This is again the same earlier several times we discussed, because there are no separate control signals. Same control signals are used to access the memory as well as the IO. So it allows the computer to use the same instructions for either input output transfers or for memory transfers. The advantage is that the load and store instructions used for reading and writing from the memory can be used to input and output data from IO registers. This is again the same, all this, this point, even this point is also talking the same thing, because same control signals, so same load instruction can be used to access the IO registers also, and the same load also can be used to access the memory also. Similarly, same store also we can go to the IO devices with the same instruction, and with the same instruction, we can come to the memory also. Only thing is address. That address is important. Where you have kept the IO devices, where you have kept the location for the memory, that address is important. Earlier, pictorially, I have represented. So with memory mapped IO, all instructions that refer to memory are also available for IO. So again, this point is repeated differently here. So with this, we conclude our all this, there are three ways that computer buses can be used to communicate with memory and IO. This is for 10 marks, sometimes for 7 marks, definitely. These slides I have shared, only these points if you remember, and if that much if you write, that is enough to bank the 10 marks, okay? So those slides are shared, very important. Okay, so that completes our discussion. Now coming to the next topic, asynchronous data transfer. So here, before this asynchronous data transfer, now we go back here again to the paint here. Let us take the another. Okay, so now here I have, suppose say this is my processor P. And here I have my IO device, suppose maybe a keyboard, for example. So now I am just typing here with the help of this is the keyboard, let us take keyboard, this IO device. And this is, let us take this as a printer. So this as a printer. This I/O as a printer. Okay. So this is a printer. So now I have given here something like A, B, C, D in a word file. So this I am commanding get the print of this ABCD to the processor. I gave the command, print command. So now how is that this printer is knowing? In fact, inside the computer what happens is for A, for example, let us say 100 or 01101, something for A. For B, similar to that, 11011, maybe 00. I don't know. These are just for rough understanding. So for C, again the same here. So like that, for example, let us say are there. But how is that printer is aware that, oh, these many bits I have to receive, these many bits I have to receive for A, and this A is a starting of the this order, and then B, these many bits are for B, and this is the second letter in this sequence, then C, and like that. How is the printer is aware? There should be some mechanism between these two so that it understands really what we mean here. So that is what this stroke, handshaking, asynchronous serial transfer all about. And moreover, this has sent this A is being no, let us say this all A, B, C, D, all been received by this. But how is the processor, whether if process still waiting, whether printer really has taken this A, this that yes, A, B, C, D been received, like that some acknowledgement should come. Then this processor can take some other decision whether to send another paper for printing or not, or some other work. Unless there is this acknowledgement from the process printer, then this processor will not be knowing that this I/O successfully received this A, B, C, D or any other. So this is just example how these two devices are actually communicating with each other, that this processor had sent something and I/O had received something, and both are telling each other that yes, you had sent something, yes, I received something. So this is called acknowledgement. So this acknowledgement, how is that really happening? So this is happening with the help of some mechanism. That some mechanism is this stroke control mechanism, handshaking mechanism, and this asynchronous serial transfer mechanism. So in this asynchronous data transfer, we are basically going to discuss what is this stroke control is all about. Before that, let us have this asynchronous data transfer introduction. So the internal operations in a digital system are synchronized by means of clock pulses supplied by common pulse generator. Internal operations in a digital system. So these are actually controlled by some clock pulse generator. These clock pulses are applied to all registers within a unit, and all data transfers among internal registers occur simultaneously during the occurrence of clock pulse. Two units such as CPU and I/O interface, earlier we took CPU in pen software, processor and printer. So this CPU and I/O interface are designed independently of each other. So inside the unit means it's okay. Inside the unit, all registers, you may operate with a common clock. But this is separate unit and this is separate unit. How do you handle these two separate units? That's the issue. So if the registers in the interface share common clock with the CPU registers, the transfer between the two units is said to be synchronous. If they are using common clock, the way you set internal operations in a digital system synchronized by means of clock pulse, then that is called synchronous system. In most cases, internal timing in each unit is independent from other, in that each uses its own private clock. If two units are operating at different clock speeds, then obviously they have to have private clocks, own clocks, individual clocks. So in that case, two units are said to be asynchronous to each other. This approach is widely used in most computer systems. This is self-explanatory. What is meant by asynchronous means? Asynchronous means all this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in one statement. If we use common clock, then it is asynchronous. If we use different clocks, asynchronous. That's it. But examination point of view, all these points you have to put. What is asynchronous data transfer means? All these points you have to put. So asynchronous data transfer between two independent units requires that control signals be transmitted between the communicating units to indicate the time at which data is being transmitted. This is where this strobe and handshaking are coming into the picture. Suppose, say, if you have this one, you have this. You have the processor. Suppose in this processor, you have a different set of, here you have ALU, your arithmetic logic unit. Inside the arithmetic logic unit itself, we have one is the arithmetic unit A, and the other is the logical unit. All right, apart from this ALU, we also have the control unit inside. So all these are actually having inside a lot of circuitry. So inside, these are having a lot of circuitry. So these circuits, inside circuitry, maybe having some flip-flops also. So these flip-flops, if are connected to a common clock, so then we call it is a synchronous. Suppose say you have one processor here, and the other is here, you have some I/O device, printer. So now the clock that this processor is operating at is different clock, and the hardware here is operating at is a different clock. So this clock is, let us say, CK1, and this is let us say CK2. Obviously CK1 will be greater than CK2. Operating frequency of the processor is much faster, much higher than your printer. So two different clocks, asynchronous. But though asynchronous, we still able to transmit something from the processor to the printer flawlessly without any problem. And printer should be able to communicate to the processor as well. That paper is not there, that ink is not there, such communication. So this communication happens flawlessly with the help of asynchronous transmission. But how? Because this is operating a different clock. That is where this mechanism, your strobe, is coming into the picture. This strobe here, one way of achieving this is by means of a strobe pulse supplied by one of the units to indicate the other unit when the transfer has to occur. This is one way. The other way is handshaking method. Another method commonly used is to accompany each data item being transferred with a control signal. Along with the data, you also have to have control signal that indicates the presence of data in the bus. The unit receiving the data item responds with another control signal, two control signals. One control signal is from the transmission, the other control signal is from the receiver. This receiver is using this control signal to acknowledge receipt of the data. This type of agreement between two independent units is referred to as handshaking. So let us see straw with the pictures here. This is called source unit, a transmission unit. This is our destination unit. We call this sort of setup here in this, if you see here arrow mark here, arrow mark is shown here. It is source to destination. This is arrow. I don't know how many of you can able to view it, but I am pointing my mouse pointer here. Here you see here there is a pointer which is pointing from source to destination. Towards destination, it is pointing towards destination. And the strobe here, there is the arrow. Even this arrow is pointed towards the destination. These two arrows are pointed towards the destination, and this is strobe signal. This strobe is originated from the source. We call it as a source initiated strobe. Source initiated strobe. Why? Source has initiated this communication. That's why source initiated strobe for data transfer. So this is the block diagram, this one. And this one is a timing diagram. This you see is a timing diagram. In this, as long this strobe is high, your data is valid. But you see here there is some gap here. This gap, I will tell now why it is. Here also there is a gap. Those, as long strobe is high, then only your data is treated as valid. If your strobe is not high, then the data is not treated as a valid. So that's the idea here. I'll just go back to the paint. So you have here one source here and one destination here. You are transmitting data from source to destination. This data is treated as a valid by the destination unit only when strobe signal is high. And this strobe is actually, you see this strobe signal arrow mark is towards the destination. That's why it is called source initiated strobe. So here the timing I was talking about, the figure B shown, this is your data. And this is your strobe. So if your strobe is high, then data is valid. But I was telling you about this gap here. You see this gap here. Even before strobe is becoming high, your data is made available. Even after strobe has gone low, but your data is still held as a high. Your data is made available. So this is because of hardware circuitry. You might have studied setup time, hold time. If you are not aware with the setup time and hold time, no issues with that. But at this point, what you have to understand is, even before this strobe signal comes, even before strobe signal becomes high here, You should have data stability. That's why even before time, we make it available. That is the point. And here, even after strobe going down here at this point, but we have to still maintain that data for some time. So this time is called setup time, and the other one is called hold time. That is for reliable operation of the devices, that your flip-flops, latches. So for that, we have to have this mechanism. But further details, if you are not aware, no issues with that at this point. Just I'm telling why this gap is. My main idea here is, concern is, why this gap is here. So somebody may think that, said that this strobe, as long as strobe is high, data should be there. Someone may take in this sense. So with that sense, they may think this sort of data representation is wrong. So that's why I'm clarifying. This sort of data representation, this gap here, data made available even before your strobe, this strobe signal is high. This gap is required. Hope this is clear. Can someone unmute and speak? Is that clear? Yes, no one responding. Are there any people?
Clear, sir.
Okay, thank you. So let us move to this another. This is destination initiated stroke. Here, if you see the arrow mark, this is coming from the destination. If you see the stroke arrow, it's coming from the destination and going towards the source. That's why it is called destination initiated stroke. And data is transferred from the source. So when stroke comes to the source unit, from the destination unit, it thinks that source thinks that destination is actually in want of some data. That's why it starts transmitting. So strobe this is called destination initiated strobe for data transfer. So again, this bit let us quickly clarify this. Once source initiated strobe and destination initiated strobe. Here, in a source-initiated strobe, a strobe signal is originated from the source unit and it is going to the destination. And in a destination-initiated strobe, destination unit, receiving unit will be initializing the strobe. So that is the difference. Now coming to the another method that is called handshaking method. In this handshaking method, to see the picture here, that will be a lot clearer. So data. Here in handshaking also we have source initiated handshaking and data initiated handshaking. So let us see first source initiated handshaking. In this source initiated handshaking, you see the source unit is sending a data valid signal, and the arrow is towards the destination. As long as data valid is there, the data that is available on the data bus is also valid. So once this destination unit receives the complete data that is there on the data bus, which is generated by the source unit, okay, then this destination unit will acknowledge by sending a data accepted signal. That's why this data accepted signal arrow mark is towards the source. So coming to this, what we call this timing diagram, that is self-explanatory. You please go through this. If you have any problems, you can ask me in the next day. We'll be having next session. At that time, you can ask. Because anyway, I am revising the past covered for 5 minutes. So during that 5 minutes, you can ask the doubts. Meanwhile, you just refer this timing diagram. Okay? So coming to this source-initiated handshaking, sequence of events, how they are occurring. That is important. You have the source unit, you have the destination unit. Source unit plays data on bus. It is doing this job first. What it is doing, source unit? Plays data on bus. Enable data value. This is the job. If you see this picture also like that. Data bus and data value. These arrow marks, if you see, these are originated from the source. So that is what in the sequence of events we are writing here. Place data on bus, enable data value. So this is what generated from the source unit. Where it should go, it should be going to the destination unit. So that's why the arrow here in the sequence of events is shown from here to here. So what it is doing, this destination unit, accept data from bus and enable data accepted signal. So once this destination unit accepts the data that is there on the bus, then it has to enable data accepted signal. After that, what it has to do, it should go to the source unit. This data accepted should go to the source unit. That's why this arrow is shown like this, going to the source side. There, what it is doing, disable data valid. Then it does this job. It disables the data valid signal. This data valid signal is disabled only when this source unit receives data accepted signal from the destination. So disabled data valid. So in during that, the meaning of that data valid, it is disabling the data valid means the data available on the bus is invalid. That is the point. So when it is happening, what is that really is here doing is on the destination side, this is the meaning of that. Disabled data accepted, since this once data accepted been received from the destination by the source unit is disabling this data valid. This data valid is disabled, now this destination should again disable this data accepted. Disabled data accepted, it indicates ready to accept data. It meaning it is actually destination unit is going to the initial state. Initial state here, there is no data accepted here. Signal is not coming out here unless it receives not any data valid and any data from the source unit. Destination unit is not going to put anything on the data accepted line here. So meaning initially data accepted signal is not available initially. It comes only when this data valid is coming to the destination unit and this destination unit receives the data from the data bus and then to acknowledge only this data accepted is kept. Once this data accepted is kept here, this source unit having received this data accepted, it disables the data valid signal, means it invalidates this. Since it has invalidated, again it may send, no? Again, if it is sending, means it should be able to send the data accepted again, right? That's why it disables itself, destination also disables data accepted. That is what happens. So, and then the initial, again, it goes to the source unit. So this sequence of events, this diagram, this arrow marks, how the flow is, that is important examination point of view. Again, 10 marks, remember this strobe and this handshaking, definitely a very important examination. Now coming to this destination initiated handshaking. So based on this source initiated handshaking, I request everyone to please go through the slides. Already I have kept on student resources. So I am just wrapping my session with this. I am not going to discuss this destination initiated handshaking. I request you people, you please go through the slides already shared. If you have any doubts, ask me on WhatsApp or tomorrow when we again start the session. Initial 5 minutes will be for revising the things. So at that time, you can ask this destination initiated. After this destination initiated, finally, we have the asynchronous transfer that we'll see next session. So meanwhile, what I do is I just want to go to this stop recording. Let me